I usually don't do personal stories, but this one was unique in that it wasn't just strange, but I found it actually frightening. Fortunately, no one was hurt, as you'll be able to see that there was potential for that to happen. This occurred about a month ago. There's more to it, but since I only experienced the end of it, that's what I'll tell. For the last year or so, we took in one of my daughter's friends. We'll call him D. D came from a troubled home and had a rough life growing up. He seemed like he wanted to do better, so we took him in and tried to get him through high school. At some point, my daughter and him started dating. They were both 18 at the time, and while I didn't like my daughter living with her boyfriend, I let it happen since it looked like he was trying to improve himself. At first, he was going to school regularly, and even started to look for a job and was staying sober. He had been battling alcohol for a while, and with a stable family and some help, it was looking like he was beating it. I'm not entirely sure what happened, but slowly he sank back into old habits. We'd find mini bottles here and there and hear from people he was shoplifting it to get his fix. After he got picked up by the police for shoplifting, again, and cheated on my daughter, we had no choice but to kick him out of the house. For a couple of weeks, it seemed like he had moved on and let things go, but then we got reports from our youngest daughter, who is 15 and her room faces the road, that she thought she saw him running across the road a couple of nights in a row. The streetlight on our block is right by the house, so she had a good lighted view of everything that happens in the front. Initially, we thought she must have been mistaken. There are other teenagers that live on our block, and we thought it was probably one of them sneaking out at night or something. Another month passed before she saw him. He came to her window, boasting that he was still staying in the house at night, and her oldest daughter was even letting him in. He also blamed my youngest daughter for him getting kicked out, since she was the one that had found out he was cheating. According to her, he had come to her window at least twice that month. She finally told us the second time because she believed our oldest daughter was actually letting him in at night. He didn't come around for almost another month after that, and the wife and I had bought some home security things, but thought it wasn't that big of a deal and didn't put them up right away. The next time he did come by, it was in the middle of the day. I was at work, and the wife had just left to take our 8-year-old to swim lessons. It was just my 2 daughters at home and our 12-year-old boy. At 11 a.m., he came in through the back door and went right to my oldest daughter's room. My oldest daughter was in the laundry room and didn't know he'd come in, but my younger daughter saw him walk by her door, so she followed him and asked him what he was doing there. He said he was waiting for his girlfriend. My youngest daughter went and locked herself in the garage without telling my oldest he was there and then called my wife. My oldest went back to her room and found him there, laying on her bed like nothing was even wrong. My wife called my oldest daughter around that time and told her she was coming back and that the police had been notified. My oldest told them this, but he kept saying he didn't care. He didn't care if my wife found him, he didn't care if I came home, and he didn't care if the cops even shot him. We're pretty sure he was drunk at this time, because when I came home 45 minutes later for lunch, the room still stunk of alcohol. My daughter finally convinced him to leave, and fortunately he did so without getting violent. My wife got home only a few minutes after he left, and the police showed up shortly after. They took statements and then went to see if he was still in the area. They didn't find him. When I got home, I heard what had happened, and thought it had to be a one-time thing. He knew he was no longer welcome in the house, and no one would be stupid enough to press their luck a second time. We later found out about 7 o'clock that evening, he went to my daughter's work, but she had the day off and wasn't there. According to her co-workers, he came in and demanded to speak to his girlfriend, and was belligerent with them when the manager told him he couldn't. They never did tell him whether she was there or not. Sometime between that incident and 8:30 that evening, he came by our house again. We never heard him, and a friend stopped by around 8:45, which is how we know the time frame. The friend knew a bit about what had happened between my daughter and this guy, and we were talking about it. I said I was concerned for my daughter, since her window was in front, and unlike my youngest daughter's window, her screen was missing. I lifted the blinds to show him, and there to my amazement, found the first pane of the double-paned glass window had been broken. I know it hadn't been like that before 6:30 that night, because I'd gone to the store to pick up a few things and would have noticed then. When we went outside to inspect the broken window, we saw a stone paver sitting in front of the window. From what I can figure out, he took the stone paver and scratched at the glass until the first pane broke. It looked like he had started on the second one, because I could see scratch marks on it, but our friend had come by and the ex-boyfriend probably left before he could finish, so as not to be seen. That would explain why no one in the house heard anything. Needless to say, we called the police to report the incident. They came by and took statements and did a check of the neighborhood, but he was gone again. As soon as they left, I felt it was time to put up the security equipment, which included some cameras. So I installed those in about an hour, and by that time I had to get ready for bed since I had work in the morning. Both my wife and oldest son downloaded the app to monitor the cameras, and since it was summer break, my son was in the habit of staying up all night to play video games, so we asked him to watch the app and let us know if anything happened. Again, I thought there was no way someone would be stupid enough to tempt fate a third time in the same day, having to have known that the police had been notified of what was happening. At 2:30 that morning, my son came barging into the room and woke us up saying that the camera had caught someone coming from the back of the neighbor's yard and crossing the street. Now, there's an easement that runs from the street to the back of everyone's property until it comes to ours. At some point, the old homeowner decided to take back the 5 feet of property lost by the easement, and for whatever reason, the city never challenged him on it, so the easement stops when it reaches our backyard. The wife and I shot awake and looked at the footage. Sure enough, it was him, but he had crossed the street and we weren't sure what he was doing. I grabbed my gun because at this point, we had no clue what his intentions were, and why he would be coming around so late at night, and with him already coming around now 3 times that day, we were pretty sure he wasn't thinking clearly. You never know what someone's intentions are when they are drunk or possibly even on drugs, which we knew he had done in the past. Nothing happened for about half an hour, so we told my son to keep watch. I tried to go back to sleep, but at this point, I was pretty well on edge. 20 minutes after my son had left, he came running back into the room, saying that Dee had tried to come in through the window in our laundry room. The laundry room is right next to the kitchen, and my son had been in there making a snack when he saw an arm come in through the window. He said he was shocked and just said Dee shouldn't be there. I went to go check it out, and the screen on the window was missing. Not just removed, but actually gone. I even went out later and looked around the house and never found it. There was a stick propping up the window as well. Here's the thing that baffles me. The window has decorative bars on it, so I'm not sure how he planned to get in. He is very skinny, so I guess he was going to shimmy between the space between the bars and the window? I'm not sure. I think his torso could have fit, but his head more than likely would have gotten stuck. We called the cops a third time and they came again and took statements and made a report. Once again, they searched the area, but he was long gone. I didn't sleep the rest of the night, and for the next couple of days, even the slightest bump around the house set me off. The morning after he tried to break in, I noticed that the Teflon screen to our back sunroom had a hole in it, right above the handle. It had been locked that night, and for the 30 minutes he wasn't seen. I suspect he had been trying to open that door, but found the screen too tough. He knows we have windows back there, and one of them has a cat door placed in it, so I think he was originally going to try to get in that way. He still hasn't been picked up for the attempted break-ins, although we know he's been to court for 4 separate shoplifting cases, and my wife and daughters have each spoken to detectives in regards to these break-ins. We have restraining orders on him as well. I don't really care too much to follow with what happens to him. I just hope he finally gets it through his head to not come around my house or my family anymore. When I was 17, my bedroom had a window looking out at my backyard. The backyard was fenced in, but on the other side of the fence were some woods and a retention pond. I'd never been scared of this, and kept the blinds open so that when the sun rose in the morning, the natural light would help wake me up. One night, I was up late on my phone with my dog laying in the bed next to me. At around 2 a.m., my dog jumped up and started barking at the window. At first, I thought he was just barking at his reflection and told him to stop, but I then realized he was looking at the left side of the window, while his reflection was on the right. I couldn't see outside the window because I had left the lamp on my nightstand on. All I could see in the window was the reflection of my bedroom. Not wanting to alert whatever might be out there that I was scared, I faked a yawn, set my phone aside, and turned off the lamp. I then laid down facing the window, and I swear I saw a set of human eyes looking back at me from the left side of the window. I drink a lot of water at night, so I had an empty bottle on my nightstand. I grabbed it and pretended to just realize it was empty. I turned on the lamp and acted like I was going to get water. I went to my parents' room and my dad told me not to worry. We had these motion-activated floodlights and they hadn't turned on, so there was no way anything was out there. I went back to my room and told myself I was just seeing things. I closed the blinds and turned on the lamp and got some sleep. When I woke up in the morning, I went to take my dog out and decided to check out the pine straw bedding underneath my window. It was visibly disturbed. I did my best to ignore that and remember what my dad said about the floodlights. That worked pretty well, until my dad tested the floodlights later that day and found that the bulbs had burnt out. And to this day, I keep my blinds closed and my lamp off when I sleep. I don't want to risk anything being able to see me, and if anything is somehow peeking through my window, I want to know it's there. If there was someone at my window that night, let's not meet. This story actually happened to me when I was living with my parents about 3 years ago. We moved to this new house at the end of 2019, right before lockdown, and multiple things happened. One night around 7 p.m., my mom and I were going home from school. It's a 20-minute ride, and my mom has this weird habit of always checking who is behind us, and that night, she noticed that this car had been there for a few minutes already. To be sure that we weren't paranoid, we slowed down and made two rounds in a roundabout, but they ended up cutting us off full speed on the small road going to our house, which wasn't really a busy road, usually, but we assumed that we were at the wrong place at the wrong time. Fast forward to lockdown. At first, everything was going well, and we collectively decided to forget about it. We were in May, so 2 months after the lockdown started, and almost the end of it. My sister was downstairs around 3 a.m., just hanging out in the living room. Just to give context, my house has lots of doors and windows in the living room. She noticed one of the doors slightly opening and assumed that someone forgot to close it and that the wind was blowing, but when she tried to push it to lock it, it felt like someone was putting their weight on it to open it up. So she screamed as loud as she could and ran upstairs to my parents. They went in the backyard to check if anyone was there. We didn't see anyone, so we just let it be a one-time thing, but my mom wasn't reassured, so she started staying up during the night in the living room to see if anything happened. During the next few weeks, nothing new happened, and she asked me multiple times to stay with her, just to be a witness in case anything did happen. Around 1 a.m., we were lying on the couch, but the lights were off because I had a headache and my mom was just scrolling through her phone. We saw a blinding light direct to our living room, which spooked me so much that I was completely paralyzed. My parents went into the backyard and still nothing. After that, we saw multiple lights and noises, and on the surveillance camera, there were weird people at our gate staring directly into our house, but as it's not technically illegal, we couldn't do anything. This continued for a few months, driving my family insane. In 2021, while we were cleaning the backyard for summer, we saw a big hole in the bushes, large enough to allow someone to go through. We didn't know what to do, but we had confirmation that someone was coming onto our property. Almost nothing happened after that, which made us believe that they knew we were onto them, but we still don't have a clue about who it was, why they were doing that, or even if they wanted to do something bad. I'm a 19-year-old female, and this happened about 2 years ago. We had just moved out of student accommodation into an actual flat with my friend group of six. The night we moved in, it was just me and one of the girls I'm close friends with. Let's call her Lucy. I had my boyfriend over at the time. Let's call him Alex. The other people who were moving in 2 weeks later, as they were all on various holidays or visiting home, so it was just the three of us. Lucy was in her room and Alex and I were smoking a joint in bed, watching kung fu movies. Him and I started to notice a man, around 300 pounds and 6 feet, pacing outside our window and looking in occasionally. We were on a basement floor at this time, but the windows are on ground level. Okay, that's weird, but we'll just make sure the windows are locked. 20 or so minutes pass, and everything seems okay, until Lucy runs into my room and says, "Babe, there's a man in the house. We left the door unlocked by accident." I got chills. I'm like, "What do you mean there's a man in the house?" Alex is frozen solid. Lucy and I go into the hall, and the huge man who we saw looking in the windows is in our hallway. We ask him, "What are you doing here?" And he pulls out his phone and shows us a text message from an unsaved number with our address written on it and something about people being inside. What the hell? He tells us he's looking for his girlfriend and that she lives here. And we're like, "No the hell she does not. Please remove yourself from our house." He says, "Okay," and then he'll phone his girlfriend. He turns his phone volume low and he's speaking to another man on the phone who is clearly not his girlfriend. With more urgency this time, we tell him to get out of our house, and he says okay. He leaves, we lock the door, and everyone is shaking. He's still on the phone to this man outside, and they're speaking a language we don't understand, but we can hear him getting angry. I tell Alex to please make the scary man go away, and he goes outside and tells him to shift away from the door, as he's really scaring us. He says okay, and his taxi is here. He walks up a dead-end street where no taxis can go. Again, what's going on? We tell our upstairs neighbors, who we had met earlier that day, about the whole ordeal. We'll call them Charlotte, Matt, and Rob. They inform us that the same man had tried to come into their house, insisting his girlfriend live there. Charlotte already had a boyfriend, who we knew of, and had also met that day. Rob has more balls than all of us, and threatened him with a knife the time he came to their house, and he never bothered them again. Over the next couple of weeks, the man would occasionally come back and look in our bedroom window. Alex was there most of the time, and I'm glad for that. I have no doubt he tried the door again, but it was always locked after that. I used to live in a three-story house with my parents, younger sibling, and our dog. We moved into this house a few months before my younger sibling was born, and that was when we first met the neighbors across the street. Lucas, who was the oldest child in their family, was always a bit strange. But there were some aspects of his personality that were more than just strange. They were straight up disturbing. It would take hours to cover everything, so I'm just going to get straight to the point. I'm almost positive that Lucas has been inside of our house in the middle of the night. Our house had a main level, upper level, and basement. It was built on a hill, so it looked like it was only two stories from the front, and the basement was connected to the backyard. The yards in this neighborhood were much larger than they are in newer housing developments, so it would have been very easy for someone to enter our backyard unnoticed. Despite this, my family was terrible about making sure all of the basement doors were locked. My younger sibling and I would always go in and out when we were playing in the backyard, or someone would go down to let the dog out, and we would end up forgetting to lock one of the doors before bed. We also lived in a safe area, where it was common for people to leave the doors unlocked. However, my family did always lock the door leading down to the basement every night, along with all of the other doors on the main level of the house. I had a messed up sleeping schedule back then, so I would usually still be awake at 3 or 4 in the morning. There are two specific instances that happened very late at night, which make me think that Lucas had been inside of our house without our knowledge. One night, I was in my bedroom on the upper level of the house. It was probably around 2:30 in the morning, when I suddenly heard the sound of an angry growl coming from downstairs. Thinking that my dog had spotted a cat in the front yard, I quickly rushed downstairs to stop him from barking and waking up my entire family. This kind of thing would happen every now and then, so I wasn't thinking too much of it at the time. But instead of going downstairs and finding my dog by the front window, I found him by the locked door that leads down to the basement. The fur on the back of his neck was standing up, and his nose was pressed to the bottom of the door. I instantly froze when I realized what was happening. There was something or someone on the other side of the basement door. I was barely a teenager at the time, so I began to panic and started making my way upstairs as quietly as possible. I woke up both of my parents, but neither of them took me very seriously. My dad just assumed that my dog was hearing random noises coming from outside, but he did eventually go down to check things out. He said that everything downstairs looked normal, but he also mentioned that we had forgot to lock one of the basement doors that night. Then there was another time that I was up late and in my room. But this time, instead of hearing my dog growling, I heard a loud bark that echoed throughout the entire house. The sound was sudden and intense, similar to a gunshot, and it almost made me jump out of my chair. Assuming again that my dog had seen a cat outside, I quickly looked out of my bedroom window and tried to spot whatever he was barking at, but my heart suddenly stopped when instead of seeing a cat, I saw Lucas running out of our front yard in the pitch black. I watched him run across the street and back towards his own house, before I rushed to close the curtains and duck out of sight. I remember sitting there, struggling to process what I had just seen, and questioning why Lucas would be in our yard in the middle of the night. I told my mom about it the very next morning, and she said that she would bring it up with Lucas's mom. Because of these two instances, because of other details that I can't include, I'm 99.9% sure that Lucas had been in our house in the middle of the night. If you knew the entire story behind this family, then you would also find the thought of this to be extremely disturbing. I do want to mention that this all happened years ago. My family no longer lives in that house, and those neighbors across the street are doing fine. But looking back on everything now, I'm realizing just how creepy the situation truly was.